Back once again, AD on the radio.
Flitter, it's you and the senorita. Whoopa blowing up the tweeter, cause it's me up in the speaker. Back in the mama seat, top down like a player. And the sound up in your ears, it is the dopest rhyme. Say, I run a game like a cheater, I'm balling like Derek Jeter.
So, yeah, my Mets lost the World Series yesterday. And it was disheartening, I got to admit. I'm not one of those people that hates other baseball teams. I just love the Mets. I love the Mets so much. When the Mets get a base hit, my heart soars. When they get a double, I about lose my mind. Anybody on the Mets hits a home run? Well, I've decided after this year's shenanigans that for the 2016 baseball season, I'm investing in my own personal defibrillation paddles for when they do stuff like that, because my poor heart can't take it. What an amazing season. What an amazing season. And look, there's tons of more qualified sports analysts talking about this all day long that you probably didn't want to hear, and that's why you're listening to this station. But, man, to see it all fall apart in the ninth inning and to see the Kansas City Royals clinch the series, I was really hoping we'd extend it for just one game. I mean, the Kansas City Royals won because they're an amazing, amazing baseball team. And they won in the ninth because if you even crack the door open a little bit, they're going to barge their way in. And they did an incredible job. But you know what's kind of interesting? I was hoping, A, the Mets would win to extend the series. But I was also sort of hoping that the Kansas City Royals, who lost the World Series last year, would get beaten, have the series extended. And if they did win, they'd win in their hometown. Because, well, not winning in your hometown, look, I don't think anyone's mad, and I'm sure the Kansas City Royals probably wanted to get it over sooner rather than later. If they could clinch the win fast as opposed to slow, that's what they wanted. That is what they wanted. But, yeah, I would have thought that it would have been nice. Knowing how I feel about the Mets, it would have been nice to see the Kansas City Royals win at home in front of their hometown crowd. Does that make sense, Funkhauser? Is that?
Yeah.
I think that's rather giving of spirit for me. I was not giving of spirit when somebody, like, I was just hanging out Friday in the lobby of iHeartMedia, doing my thing, getting ready to go on the air, and some competition winner was picking up her prizes. And understand, it's my job to be nice to listeners. That's what I do. And I was wearing my Mets shirt, as any good Mets fan would, the day before they were about to play in the World Series. And I was standing there in my Mets shirt, and this chick who's winning tickets says to me, and what's weird is afterwards, people, after this exchange, people were like, dude, I think she was hitting on you. And I was like, I lost all sense of self-control when she said to me, sorry, your Mets suck, you know, in a playful, jovial way. And, like, I spend so much time being diplomatic. I spend so much time being patient with listeners that come at me and say stupid things. Because sometimes listeners say stupid things, you know, like, hey, how come you're not playing more deep cuts from Metallica at 2 o'clock in the afternoon? And then I have to do them the courtesy of explaining how it works. And if more people wanted to hear that, then that's what we'd be playing. But they're out there on their own on that one. And we try to make everybody as happy as we can all the time. But we can't please everyone simultaneously. So too bad. So sorry. You're not getting your Metallica deep cuts at 2 o'clock in the afternoon right as you're getting out for your lunch shift. It's just not going to happen. Like, I have to have these long conversations with listeners all the time where I'm diplomatic and explain things to them in a thoughtful, kind, courteous way, because hey, they're listeners. They pay our mortgages. They deserve that. And you know what? I love my radio family. Anybody that enjoys this little show half as much as I do, man, I'm so humbled by it. But when this chick, and I don't even know if she listened to my station, but when this chick was like, sorry, your Mets suck. And I was just like, oh, are you from Kansas City? And she was like, yep. And I was like, you know what? I'm glad you've got the Royals. I'm glad you've got the Royals because let's be real here. That's all you've got. I've been to Kansas City once. It was closed. And she was like, that's not true. That's not true. Kansas City is a great place. It's a wonderful city with so much stuff. We have so much stuff going on in Kansas City. I was like, if by so much stuff you mean third-rate barbecue and lots of basement meth, then yes. Yes, you do. You've got lots and lots of stuff. And I was like, but congratulations on your Royals. They're a very impressive team. And she walked off in a huff. And honestly, not bad looking, kind of attractive. And and this guy afterwards, he was like, dude, I'm pretty sure she was hitting on you. I was like, was it? Well, yeah. But it's just like the passion you feel for sports, it just sometimes bypasses every sort of like solid, stable piece of human nature that you've got. It like, it just goes right through all your common sense. And man, I think that's what makes baseball so unbelievable for me. Postseason baseball, you live and die by every pitch, every error, everything. And it's just, it's insane. And I'm sad that the New York Mets lost. I really am. But what an amazing season. What an incredible job they did at getting to this series. And not only were they were beat by an incredible, incredible team who lost the World Series last year. So I like our chances in 2016. I really do. And if you're like me, you're a Mets fan that woke up this morning that went, I can't wait for opening day in 2016. And that's pretty much all I have to say about that. I am suffering from a candy hangover, though, just because I decided to eat my feelings. And by my feelings, I meant everything that a trick-or-treater didn't pick up last night. And it was delicious, and now I don't feel so hot. But I am cheered up by the fact that the legendary Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top is with us on the show today. Thank you so much for hanging out. Can't wait for this one. Today on the show, nothing really matters other than the fact that we are joined by the absolutely legendary Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top fame, who's talking about his new solo album, Perfectamundo, which is out on Friday, as well as which places in his hometown have the very best tacos. Also, Funkhauser is really, really sick, so he earns the super part of the Super Producer to the Stars title he rolls with.
Where the left and right come together for fundamental truths. AD on the radio. Every day you're going and working, running that rat race at that pace, and that place will leave a bad taste for anyone, everyone, working day after day. So buddy, I gotta say, yo, there's gotta be a better way, yeah. So today is a good day. Yeah. Yeah, it is a Monday. It is a Monday, and Mondays traditionally suck things that we can't talk about on the radio and remain employed. Not only is it a Monday, but it's also a post-Halloween weekend Monday edition of the show, which means you're probably suffering from two different types of hangover. The candy hangover, I'm dealing with that. I'm having a hair of the Jolly Rancher that bit me. And you're probably also suffering from the hangover that you got from imbibing entirely too many adult beverages while dancing vigorously in your sexy Mr. Potato Head costume all weekend long and making a fool of yourself. But today is a good day because the legendary Billy Gibbons, the great Billy Gibbons, a man who's made such an incredible contribution to music, an amazing man, Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top joins us on the show today to talk about his new album, Perfectamundo, which is, now, when you hear that Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top has a solo album coming out, it's a little bit confusing because the guy's basically the driving force behind ZZ Top, and it's not like the other guys don't make a contribution, but how is Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top's solo record going to differ from an actual ZZ Top record? Well, somehow he wound up making a Cuban jazz record, and it's unbelievable. It's a fantastic listen, and we're going to talk to him, and we're going to hear some of the new album. But the new Billy Gibbons album, Perfectamundo, is out this Friday, November 6th. Is that right, Funkhauser? I'm still confused because albums used to come out on Tuesdays, and now they come out on Fridays. And this Friday is November 6th, right?
Yeah, everything's all out of whack now that there's no like record stores anymore. Yeah, Friday.
Yeah. Yeah, no one lines up at midnight to buy the new anything anymore, and it's kind of sad. But for that reason, Billy Gibbons is dropping his new solo album, Perfectamundo, on Friday, and we get to talk to him about it, and we get to hear music from the album. By the way, quick heads up, set your DVRs. He's going to be on Conan tomorrow as well. But until Billy Gibbons here, Gibbons gets here, I think there's no point in really getting into anything. It's all just leading up to Billy Gibbons. We're not going to discuss any big, large, earth-shattering topics today. We're just going to talk a little bit about what's going on in the news. I mean, shall we do that, Funkhauser? What is going on in the news?
Well,
and how are you feeling? I want credit where credit is due to Funkhauser. You are on. Yeah. You're on how many different types of antibiotics at the moment?
Well, I'm on three.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on Sturgamidapatidatan, and then I'm also on Polygamidap. And the third thing that makes me talk better.
You know, there are times where I regret that we're not in the same room while we do radio. This is not one of them. I'm very happy to have miles and miles of rooms and glass separating you and me on a day when you are imminently contagious.
Otherwise, I'd be like, hey, AD, can you drop these four things in my ear hole, please?
Oh, no, yeah. Thanks. I mean, love you like a brother and everything, but I will never be administering any types of medication for that. You have a girlfriend for this reason.
Yes.
Hey, Funkhauser, I just got 12 new text messages from you.
It's still happening?
It's still happening.
Oh, this is crazy. I have a bad cell phone today, apparently.
Yeah. I've gotten, Funkhauser was trying to get at me about something really important earlier, and I ignored his text messages because it was one of 20 that his phone kept sending me. So in all of that, there was a panicked thing from Funkhauser, which I was like, ignore, delete, whatever. And, anywho. Thank you for soldiering on today, and thank you so much for setting up this interview with the legendary Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top.
I came dressed sharply. You see
what
you see there? That
every girl is crazy for that.
I've heard things,
you know. And I have to say, I gotta say, today is a day where you are performing incredible things under great amounts of duress when you are sick. So today is the day that you earned the super in the Super Producer to the Stars part.
Now give me one
title.
Of it then. Thank you.
All right, let's get into the news. What's up?
NBC is developing a series based on the book Heaven is for Real.
Yeah, Heaven is for Real, I think, is sort of, isn't it the kid that died and came back to life? Do we know the backstory on this one? Heaven is for Real. I'm pretty sure it was a kid that died, came back to life, and said he saw heaven. Small town father must find the courage. I think it's this idea of this kid that died and came back to life and said that heaven is for real. But what's interesting is a little while ago, if this is indeed the story that the TV series is based on, that kid said, I made it all up. not true. Just looking for attention. To which NBC said, not a problem. We can still develop 30 minutes a week on that. I don't know if it's the same kid that died, came back to life, said heaven is real, and then admitted he was lying later. But there is a story like that. So, yeah, NBC developing a series based on the book Heaven is for Real. 30 minutes a week of different shots of Kate Upton's cleavage. That would prove it for me. Go on.
Taylor Swift dressed as Olaf from Frozen for Halloween.
Yeah, first time a snowman costume made somebody look less white than they were already.
Not cool. Not cool, dude. Kim Kardashian dressed as herself on Saturday.
Yeah. Thus continues the trend of women going as whores for Halloween.
I don't understand.
please continue.
Bill Cosby had a Halloween party.
Yep. The only candy served? Baby roofies. Oh my gosh, the legendary Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top will be with us next. Thank you so much for joining us. Joining the conversation at ADSXE at Funk FM.
Radio 104.1.
Like most kids from a privileged white upper middle class suburban background, for a significant portion of his childhood, he was pretty convinced he was down. AG on the radio.
Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top fame, welcome to the show. Thank you so very much for gracing us with your presence today.
Well, you got it, man. We're ready to charge large with you. It's let's do it to it.
We're ready to make some radio magic today. Have you ever been asked to do voice work for for movies and stuff?
Yes, I did the. I used to do this TV, this children's program called the Power Rangers. And I was the bad guy. I was Vile Vine. Why did you come to my planet?
Are you kidding me? How did I miss that one? That's amazing.
Yeah, it was.
Oh my God,
it was crazy.
You have a solo album out, Perfectamundo, which is coming out on Friday, and this is the first solo record you've released, even though ZZ Top's been in the game for like 40 years, and I'm really curious to talk about that. But first and foremost, I wanted to know, like, I have this go-to question that whenever I get to talk to a great musician, I kind of ask him, because when I was a kid, I heard Jerry Cantrell from Alice in Chains interviewed once, and the DJ in England asked him, hey, if you had to pick one record or one song or one television appearance or one concert or something like that that made you go, okay, this is it, I have to do music, what would it be? And quick as a flash, old Jerry was like, oh, Elton John, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road, which is not something you'd expect from the guitar player of Alice in Chains. So that's kind of become my go-to. So for you, what would you say that would be?
Wow. When I was five, my younger sister and I attended with my mom. We went down and saw live and in person Elvis Presley.
Wow.
They just did it. I mm-hmm. saw that and I said, that's for me. Yeah. No question about it.
at age 5 years old, it all just became, all right, this is what I'm doing.
Well, yeah, I'd been banging on a metal garbage can since I was three, so it all kind of made sense. Elvis had his band behind him, and they all had parts, and they all knew what to do. It fell into place. As I looked upon that, that was a visual that stimulated all the dots connected.
Mm.
That was good.
And there's something very powerful about. Do you think it was seeing music played together by a group? I mean, like, you're five, you're just connected. There's all sorts of dots you've only started to connect at 5 years old. But when you see the power of people playing music together, that's really something to kind of sort of behold. Do you think that had a lot to do with it, seeing, like, a band in action?
Exactly, and that is the key word. It was together. It was different people spread out far and wide. But at the same time, the experience was hearing it as one thing. They were together.
Mm. And didn't you, like, I seem to remember, because I'm kind of a Billy Gibbons fanatic, I got to be honest with you. So I've watched a lot of your interviews on online and wherever I can find them. And there's a fantastic one that you did from Kid Rock's barn where you told the story of being taken out to different clubs and different places to see music. But was it your housekeeper?
Yeah, Stella, Big Stella. Stella Matthews, she was, well, the mom, Big Stella, then there was Little Stella, then Dorothy, then Minnie, and then...
Oh, okay, hold on.
Yeah.
Like, for those that haven't heard the story, Big Stella, Little Stella, Dorothy, Minnie, explain who these people are, because, like, to you, these are just people in your life, but to people listening to this, this is, like, rock and roll history. This is, like, the foundation being laid for a legend, so... Please go a little deeper into this.
Yeah, it starts off with the question, well, how did this inspiration to, you know, attempt to become an interpreter of this great art form, the blues, come mm-hmm. about, and how that came about? And we had a housekeeper that resided over in Fourth Ward, and my dad, the orchestra leader dad, would find, three or four nights a week, my younger sister, Pam, and I would spend the night with the housekeeper and her clan. And by the end of the day, Big Stella would be, she'd be ready to retire at 8 o'clock at night. So when slumber came tiptoeing in, little Stella picked up the paces, grabbed me and put my little sister in her arms, and down the street we went. There was a little, it was not little, it was a destination, a night spot. It was a black nightclub destination right there in Houston, and everybody came through town. You name it. Howlin' Wolf, Jimmy Reed, B.B. King, Muddy Waters, the whole line of blues. It's the who's who of blues lists.
And you were how old being taken by your babysitter to see these? You were taken by your babysitter at how old to see Howlin' Wolf and B.B. King?
I was five. My sister was three. Then it was six. And then it was seven. We just didn't want to let it go.
Oh, my gosh, that's incredible. I mean, sorry for making you retell a story that I'm sure you've told a bunch of times, but it's just, it's absolutely incredible. And your dad was like a concert pianist and an orchestra conductor. So if I'm getting this right, he would have to go to work, conduct the orchestra, which is something you do at night. And you got left with your housekeeper, who would then take you to a club in Fourth Ward in Houston. And by the way, I'm the afternoon guy on a station in Houston called The Buzz, so I know exactly the neighborhood you're talking about.
Oh, yeah.
And so she would take you there at age five when your dad was conducting an orchestra. So your classical musician father would leave the house and you would go get exposed to the blues. Like there was really nothing else you could do besides music. It was almost predestined.
Well, it was that pretty much carved in stone, I guess you'd say, at this point, looking back. Yeah, that corner was at the curve of Taft and West Gray. And
I know exactly where you're talking about.
You'd have to dig deep into the photographic history of that particular neighborhood. But I mean, it looks a little different now, but you know, some of those energies move on. In fact, there's another track off this new disc. Perfecto Mundo is not just the title of one song. It is one song, but there's another one, Picking Up Chicks on Dowling Street. And it's a little bit deeper into town, but, Dowling Street is still a very robust avenue. It was for the black part of Houston's giant community even back then. It's coming back to life now. I've even heard they're revitalizing the El Dorado Ballroom on Dowling Street.
Yeah, there's so much going on in Houston. It's just, it's growing and it's growing. And it's like, which brings me to an interesting point. I don't know where you spend most of your time, but when I first moved from New York City to Houston, I remember I went to, I think it was an art show or something like that, or a gallery opening. And there you were, hanging out, taking pictures and really sort of like taking it very sort of, you're a very active part, it seemed, at the time of Houston's cultural scene. Is that something, do you still live there? Do you still stay there? Because it seems like you pop up there more often than not.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can't get out of Houston. I mean, once you're there, you're there. You cannot get. Well, the heat won't let you get out of there.
Yeah.
My girlfriend went down there, and I said, so it was your first trip out of Los Angeles. How'd you like Houston? She goes, I dig it, man. It's trying to learn how to walk through mayonnaise.
It's totally true. Well, here's the thing, though. I notice when, I'm in California that, people don't understand the value of air conditioning outside of Texas. Houston, everybody's got it set to a chilly 65 at all times. And the only time you're uncomfortable really is when you leave the house till you walk to your car until your car cools down.
Sure.
And then you're all good. But then you get to California and everyone's like, oh, it's set to 72. It's beautiful. You get a cool breeze. I'm like, I'm sweating. And they're like, you're from Houston. You shouldn't be complaining. I was like, really? Try me, bitch. I'm complaining. I'm used to being 65 because I'm from the H.
Oh, yeah.
So, So you can't get out of Houston, no matter where you roam, no matter what you do, no matter how many times you go to places like Havana and play a jazz festival and get invited to make albums like the one you've just made. You're always going to be a Houston boy, you think?
I think so. I mean, we could spend the next day, or no, excuse me, we could spend the next decade just running the list of great restaurants. Someone said, Houston, Texas? Yeah, I said, well, it's a great music town, but it's also a great restaurant town. And I think... due to the heat and the bumper to bumper scene on any given avenue on any given time, a lot of people take refuge and they say, pull over, let's go in there. They got some good food in there.
Mm. Yeah, no, it's really true. Like Houston, I think, got named the best restaurant town in all of America. People think Chicago, people think New York City. But you know what? I think the thing is there's so many restaurants in Houston that if you don't come with the goods, you're not going to last more than a week. So you have to be excellent. Like any restaurant in Houston that's been open more than a week and a half is going to be amazing. So,
oh, yeah.
I wanted to talk to you about, look, you know, you've been up in the game for 40 years with ZZ Top, and this is your first ever solo album. And I think I know a little bit about how this came about with you being invited to play at, was it the Havana Jazz Fest?
It is. That's a standing invite. In fact, that's where this Billy Gibbons and the BFGs aggregation will open up. We go to Havana in the middle of December. We got three shows booked before we bring it back to these shores, but it's going to be an interesting outing. We cut a video for the lead single, which, you know, speaking of Houston, Roy Head's great cornerstone of blues and R&B, whose song Treat Her Right from 1965 found its way to being given our Cubanized version. And cutting the video, I said, well, how do we wrap this up? And it gave us an opportunity to bring out something that everybody knows, all the famous American cars that are still left running in Cuba. And we've got this 1950 Ford, shiny red, chopped, repowered, repainted. It is the expression of Cuba right there at the end of the Treat Her Right video. So it made sense.
You know what? We'll continue the conversation with Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top fame in just a little bit, but we're talking so much about this incredible new record that you've made. I think it's only right that people hear some of it. So let's take a listen. Billy Gibbons, new album Perfectamundo out on Friday. We'll talk to you more about this in just a little bit, but let's hear some music, shall we? A cover of Roy Head's hit Treat Her Right. It's awesome. You're in for a treat. Also, do yourself a favor. Check out the video on the interwebs. Billy Gibbons, Treat Her Right.
AD on the radio.
Hey, I'm AD, and if you've just started listening, we are joined in the studio today by the legendary Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top. So, Perfectamundo, for people that don't know, Billy Gibbons and the BFGs, your solo album Perfectamundo is out on Friday. And when I heard about it, I was like, don't take this the wrong way, but isn't every solo album sort of, I get the impression that you are the driving force behind it, and it, a lot of what ZZ Top is about is your vision. I was like, why would he need to do something different from ZZ Top? And then I listened to what it is. I was like, oh, this is not a ZZ Top record. This is Cuban jazz. And weren't you kind of like surprised when you were invited over to play a jazz festival?
Yeah.
Was it? Yeah.
I said, how did my name wind up on a jazz roster of all things? Mm. And I guess we're still curious, but you know, I know what we do. There's no getting around it. The blues influences will constantly be part of that thread. And at the same time, we didn't want to crash the party. We didn't want to miss the party. And we decided, well, let's just peel the onion and see if we can start making headway in that Cuban fashion, which I think, you know, once you listen to it, it ain't ZZ Top. It's something really weird. It's I like it.
It's super cool. It's almost like when I first heard some of the clips off of the album, I was like, it almost sounds like Tom Waits to me. Like it's you, but it's, I don't know. It seems as though like messing with a different art form almost. It sort of freed you up to do some different things. Would you say that's true?
Yeah, the Tito Puente / Tom Waits cloud was constantly over the studio. My voice got scratchier and the timbales got louder.
Good. Well, this brings me to an interesting point. Like, you've done so much. You've done so much. You've played with, you know, for people that aren't aware, you've played with everyone from Ministry to Queens of the Stone Age to Kid Rock and now Latin Jazz and Brooks and Dunn. You've got a recurring role on the TV show Bones. You have your own barbecue and hot sauce. And it seems like you have this attitude of just saying yes to everything that life throws at you. And I wanted to talk a little bit about that because, look, you've been doing this a long time, and it seems like just obviously a person goes through life and makes their own opportunities, but you seem to have an attitude where opportunities come to you. Why is that? I mean, is it just saying yes to stuff that seems a little off the wall?
Yeah.
Like a jazz festival. Okay.
Yeah.
You know,
it is embracing that passion. It's all around us. You just got to, you know, it's bubbling under. So why not let it boil? And, you know, when somebody lights the fuse, then you got to go out and light the fire. And I think I speak for my partner, Frank Beard, the man with no beard sitting at
the man with no beard and ZZ Top, the one guy without a beard.
Yeah. And Dusty Hill, our fearless bass player. We've constantly tried to figure out, what is that similar element that it's getting to enjoy what we get to go do. Mm-hmm. And well, that's one part of it. I think the other challenge is accepting that propellancy. We don't know who's going to make the first mistake, so we're constantly on our toes.
Right. But I mean, where would you say that attitude comes from? Because, like, you know, I look at your body of work, and I know this is a little deep and a little esoteric, but I look at your body of work and look at everything that you've accomplished and look at everything that you're still accomplishing. And I was like, so many people, so many artists, like, bend themselves all out of shape, you know, like, and kind of go against the grain of life, where you seem to have found a way to absolutely swim with the current and let life take you into some really cool places, yet direct yourself at the same time. Where do you think that attitude comes from? Was it your parents? Was it your upbringing? Was it Stella? You know, like, how does a guy get like that? I'm asking because I want to be like that. Like, it's just amazing.
Yeah, and there's one simple phrase that seems to resonate, and I think everybody can learn to play what you want to hear. And if you're going to strum on a guitar, bang on the drums, hit the keyboard, it's just that. It's first of all, it's all in the hands, And and if you can get that muscle memory to fall in line, learn to play what you want to hear, and then you got it. You at least you're on your way.
Well, I think it's a great metaphor for life as well. If there's something you want to do, I guess what you're telling us to do is create it. I was expecting to talk about music. I was expecting to talk about the new album Perfecto Mundo, which is out this Friday, and how everybody should go get it because it really is an entertaining listen. If you're into ZZ Top, if you're into Billy Gibbons, then this is something that you definitely won't want to miss. And even if you're not, it's definitely something that you won't want to miss. But I feel as though we got some life lessons from not only a legend, but a legend from the great city of Houston. Thank you very much. I can't tell you how much it meant to talk to you here today, and I could talk your ear off for an hour and a half, and still have tons more questions that I'm dying to ask you. So maybe you'll come back sometime, but if not, this has been an absolute honor.
Well, my pleasure, and having the opportunity to conduct this exchange, we can expand our horizons from arroz and frijoles with this Cuban twist. Now we can have black beans and plantains. Let's go for it.
Yeah. Have you ever, just out of curiosity, have you ever eaten at Chacho's on Westheimer?
Ah, love it. Love Chacho's. Yeah, man. Come on.
I find that in Houston, there's different places that do different things really well, but absolutely nobody beats their quesadilla. Have you had the spinach and mushroom quesadilla? They're the only place in town that does that, I think.
And they do it right. They absolutely do it right. Yeah. You and I'll have to get together. We'll put the burn on. I'll bring over the guacamole recipe, and we'll leave the rest of it to guesswork.
if we could eat Mexican food one day together, I could leave this mortal coil a happy and satisfied man, having had so much more happen to me than I ever thought would. Billy Gibbons, you're a scholar, you're a gentleman, you're a genius, and maybe one day we get to split a quesadilla. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, brother. We'll see you soon, senor. Bueno.
Take it easy, Chief.
Real radio. Real radio. 104.1.
Now, someone who everybody wants to punch in the face. AD on the radio.
Dude, I think I just got invited out for tacos by Billy Gibbons of ZZ Top.
Well, probably like, him, but not all of his promotions people. They're all pissed because we went too long.
We did?
Yeah, everybody's staring at me.
Oh.
It's weird in here.
Like all the other interviews were finished in a timely fashion, and they were like clawing at the glass, being like, "Get him out of there! We've got a schedule to keep.
He's got things to do."
So you were running him around earlier for his radio tour. That was your responsibility to keep him going from radio station to radio station, talking to different people. I'm peeling back the curtain a little bit so people know what Funkhauser has been dealing with here today while he's been sick, by the way. Like I said earlier in the show, definitely earning the super part of the super producer to the stars title that he rolls with. But here's the thing. Let me guess. Every single other interview was perfectly on time, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Yeah, but did you notice how Billy Gibbons just kind of sort of wanted to keep talking?
Well, yeah. You got like you were the best interviewer he had. All the other ones were like, well, tell me about the album that comes out and this and that and the other thing.
You know, honestly, I pride myself in, it's like everything. I think I'm an idiot. I think I'm a moron. But I think I'm smarter than 99.9% of the people that I meet, and that kind of scares me. I remember, who was it? It was, what's that angry political comedian? Doug Stanhope said that once. He was like, I'm a moron, but I'm smarter than 99.9% of the people I meet, and that worries me about the state of the world. I feel that way, like, literally all the time. I don't think I'm smart. I don't think I'm special. I don't think I'm great. I think I just put a little bit of thought into some of the things I do. Radio interview. You know what? It doesn't surprise me that he wanted to bail on all the other radio interviews, and he wanted to hang out and talk with us. You want to know why, Funkhauser?
I do want to know why. Tell me.
Because I actually did a teeny tiny bit of homework on him. I mean, I didn't have to do much homework. Like, I am a huge Billy Gibbons and ZZ Top fan. That was easy for me. You know, all I had to do was make sure I knew the name of his album and how it came about, and the rest is just all up here. Like, I've known a lot about him for a really long time, especially if you've spent any time in Houston. ZZ Top are kind of legends. And that guy's just like an ambassador of goodwill. He's such a decent human being. You never hear a story about him being anything other than awesome to the people that he meets. He's just a truly awesome guy, knows who he is, understands his place in the world, gets that he's pretty much a legend and is cool with that, and treats everybody around him in a really, really down-to-earth and awesome way. But I remember the first time I realized that radio interviewers were terrible, and I started understanding why sometimes when you go into an interview, you're going into an adversarial situation, because they've done about 20 of these interviews today and they're miserable because the average radio guy is just an idiot. I remember once I was interviewing the guys in Soul Asylum. You know the Soul Asylum guys?
Runaway train, never going back.
Not only Runaway Train, but like a very sort of integral part of the do-it-yourself punk rock scene in the 80s and 90s. Like a big deal. Like David Perner has had a humongous effect on everything that came before him and everything that came after him in terms of guys getting in a van and taking it to the people and experiencing big success and fighting for their music. And it's just, it's incredible, incredible guy of great weight and significance. And you know what I like to do before I interview people? There's so much out there now. There's so much out there now where it's like you can get an idea of what you're letting yourself in for when you interview someone. And before I was going to interview Soul Asylum, I remember, you know, looking up a video of an interview they'd done before. And I won't name the name of the air personality, and I won't say what station or city they were in, but it was in a big city. It was in a market big enough where this guy should be ashamed of himself. Like, David Perner came into the interview, and the guy was like, so, what you been doing since the 90s? I was like, oh, you unspeakable clown. Only because that's the sort of BS that people like this have to deal with. And then they come and talk to me and they're all on pins and needles being like, what is this jerk gonna say? This is why comedians like Patton Oswalt, and this is why the greats don't like coming on radio shows and talking to people like us, because the average sort of like radio yuck is like, hey, got any wacky stories from the road, Louis C.K.? At which point Louis C.K. is like, kill me now. And this is so, like, I don't think I'm even good. I think I'm just better in that I do a tiny little bit of homework and have respect for the artist that's rolling through. And that is why Billy Gibbons wanted to hang out and talk with us and have fun, as opposed to the usual. I mean, you don't have to name names, you don't have to name cities, but I'm going to guess this is my impersonation of the people that I would imagine he dealt with beforehand. Hey, let me say something about me. Let me talk about me. Let me talk about me for a little bit. And let me tell a story about how some other rock star is a personal friend of mine. And then in some way, shape, or form related to your album, which I know nothing about because I haven't listened to, and I know zip, zing, nada about it, except for this sheet that's in front of me that just got handed me 2 seconds ago, which I haven't had the courtesy to read. Is that how it went?
Pretty much, yeah. For some of them. I mean, there were some guys that really wanted to talk to them, and they had accents like this, so, you know, thank you.
Right.
But, you know, you and him bonded the most, I think. Maybe it was either because it was at the end or because you're really fun, according to the other ones.
You know what it is? Maynard James Keenan from Tool. And I remember, before started in radio, Maynard James Keenan from Tool has this reputation as being a guy that's really, really difficult to interview. And yet I've heard interviews that he's done that have gone great, where he really opens up and he's fantastic and he's amazing. Like, if you listen to the interview he did with Marc Maron, it's like an hour and a half of gold from start to finish, where he's just giving them everything. And I remember reading an interview with him about interviews where he said, well, there's two types of people that I do interviews with. He's like, there are those that welcome you in and have a one-on-one conversation with you where you talk about things that are interesting to you and interesting to the people reading or listening. We call these people journalists. And he said, then there are those that have a pre-prepared list of 10 questions. And before you've even finished answering the first question, they are on to the next one. We call those people never again. And I was like, booyakasha, this is how I'm going through life. This is how I'm going to conduct myself in interviews. One day I'm going to get a chance to interview Maynard James Keenan from Tool, and he's going to say that it is one of the good ones. That, hey, we call this guy a journalist, and we would maybe do this again. And it's just like, you know what? It's common courtesy. And look, I know the folks on the Monsters and the Phillips File, and I know the folks on the News Junkie on Real Radio 104.1 in Orlando, Florida, where we're carried, do great interviews. And I've worked with a lot of people that do really great interviews. Ramon Robles Jr. on KPRC, the program director of that station in Houston, does fantastic interviews. But you know what? Interviews, such a big part of the radio job that I'm surprised that more of us don't do it a little bit better than we do, or a lot of it.
Yeah, we should say, though, that that was really the guy from ZZ Top and not Jim Phillips from the Phillips File.
Oh, my God. Yeah, voice boxes that were separated at birth. It was really, really good stuff. Man, I just, like, I feel, it's just like when a guy like that that's made a contribution that way to music is going to spend 10, 15 minutes with you talking about music, man, that's a big deal. That's a privilege. And I believe that you should treat it with the respect that it deserves. And I was like super, super stoked to have him on. That actually made me feel better about the Mets losing. How about you? Oh, you don't care.
I don't care.
You don't care about that.
Go sports.
Go sports. How much time do we have left, Funkhauser?
Plenty of time, man.
We got plenty of time left. I've decided. Do you fly much, Funkhauser?
I've flown 7 times.
What, in your life?
In my life. One time.
Really?
I know about. 6 times. Yeah. I'm not really a flyer. I'm more of a driver. You get me in the car.
Well, yeah. I decided last time I flew that I was going to invest in one of those. Like, they look so stupid, and I always laugh at people when they walk in with them under their arms, or I see them blowing them up. But I'm going to invest in those neck pillow things. I'm getting myself one for the next flight.
A lot of people ask me if I try jokes out on Twitter, and I don't, but I do try them out on LinkedIn. That is a very dumb thing to say, but a lot of fun. I was in Austin at the airport, and I was buying a neck pillow, and the guy at the counter was like, if you get one neck pillow, it's $17.99, but if you get two, it's only $20.99. I was like, oh, I would totally do that if I had two necks. The guy behind the counter laughed. The guy behind me laughed. He'd, like, never heard a joke. He was like, what do you call what you just did? He was blown away.
Yeah, I fly a lot, mostly back and forth between Houston and Cali now. These are my two homes because of the work I do at 94.5 The Buzz in Houston, and then Rock 105.3 in San Diego, and I'm back and forth a lot. And I've always seen those neck pillows, and I've always thought, in no way, shape, or form, is that something I'm going to do. It's not cool. It's not hip. It's like when I see people, especially the ones that, like, because you have two options with the neck pillows. One, you have the ones that come sort of like fully fabricated.
Pre-necked.
Like, yeah, well, it's just like you got the neck pillows that are fully fabricated. You just put them around your neck. But then you got to be that person that carries around a neck pillow. And they don't really fit all that well into any bag. And then you're walking around like an idiot with a neck pillow. Or you got to be this guy that sits next to you on the plane and starts blowing them up. It's like, and I feel their hot breath on my neck. And I look over and like, sorry, blowing up my neck pillow. I'm like, oh, God, it's terrible. Awful. And I resolved that I wouldn't be a neck pillow person, but based on comedian Eugene Merman and his take on neck pillows and my incredible lack of comfort on my last couple of flights from Texas to Cali, I think I'm just going to go ahead and invest in one.
Should we mention the fact that we're going to be here tomorrow?
Oh, yeah. 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 For people listening in Orlando, Real Radio 104.1 in Orlando, Florida. Now the soccer season is over. Now that the soccer season is over and done with, We are going to be on, count them, 1, 2, 3, 4 days a week, Monday through Thursday at 8 o'clock on Real Radio 104.1.
So, yay, and sorry.
Yeah. gosh. Yeah, seasons are changing. Focuses on sports are shifting. And you know what? I have to say, I got to get into shape now. Like most people say that they've got to get into shape. Most people make that promise to
themselves. Now, right?
Well, see, this is my point. Most people make that promise to themselves on January 1st. They're like, this is the year. This is the year that I'm going to become a ripped, toned, shredded, single-digit body fat having six-pack rocking super athlete, and I'm going to do it starting today, January 1st, as soon as I finish up this leftover mashed potato and gravy. I am on that workout train. No, I feel sleepy. Maybe I shouldn't have had all the turkey the day after. And, like, it just, you know what? I've decided to head it off the pass. I'm going to start getting in shape now. Like, I have to get into shape because with Halloween coming and going, I've lost my very last excuse to be out of shape. I got to get into shape. I know the holiday food thing looms large. And I can't wait to eat my weight in butter basted, triple deep fried bacon wrap, honey glazed turkey. Like, as much as I can shove down my cavernous, gaping gullet of that stuff, I'm going to do. But as of Halloween, I've run out of excuses. I'm going to start doing stuff. In the spring, my excuse was that you don't know if any of that fitness equipment was licked by Miley Cyrus. In the summer, my excuse was that, like everyone else in America, you get all the exercise you need furiously waddling after the ice cream truck. And now Halloween is over. I can no longer tell people that I've decided to go a sexy Jabba the Hutt this Halloween, so I'm keeping the weight on. So I'm going to start right now. Ready? Ready? Here I go. One! That was me thinking about doing a sit-up. Good for me. Don't want to overdo it on the first day.